Hello, I'm Carol Portlock, and tonight we have the opportunity to hear a special presentation from Susan Sussman, and she's going to be talking in the presentation with the title Capturing Awe. It's been recommended that you turn your device, if you can, to a horizontal view rather than a vertical view, certainly for the phone and also potentially for iPad kinds of things, because as we capture awe, it's potentially in the horizontal position, as the original picture in the ad was showing looking out at the sky and the mountains near. I'm going to leave my introduction there, and Susan will be able to fill in her bio a little bit and. on a journey of capturing awe.
Okay. I didn't have that in my script, but it'll probably show up. Okay. So there is. Okay. Are you all seeing the first painting?
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
Great. So thank you all for coming and looking at my paintings and listening to me talk about them. I'm gonna see if I can, I'm trying to see more of you. There we go. Oh, there we go, great. I called this talk Capturing Awe, which is the title I had for my solo show at Prince Street Gallery a little more than a year ago. The paintings in that show were all images of my experience living and working on a cattle ranch in Wyoming. In fact, this picture that I used for the title is the view from the side of my porch one evening. My friends and I used the word awesome a lot to describe the views in Wyoming. I thought we sounded like teenagers. So I looked up awe to see what we were trying to put into words. And this is what the dictionary said, that awe is a feeling of reverence, something spiritual, that awe contains wonder, the sense of being in the presence of something really big, vast, like the ocean or the mountains or the sky. I was surprised to see that awe had an element of fear or dread, and maybe that's why we use the word awful. And then finally, awe contained the sense of beauty, of the sublime, a kind of extreme beauty. So this is actually a real photograph off the side of my porch in Wyoming. And I think I was in awe of everything there. I was in awe of the light, the way the light changed, the colors, the scale. These are real pictures. We took several of them every night. Colors were just crazy, just wild. I was in awe of the size of things. The sky was big, the mountains were big, the distances were long. My husband and I did the actual cattle work, which was exciting and physically challenging and took us into beautiful places. I think you can see the proof of that because you can see my horse's ears in the front of this one. And maybe you can see, depending how big your screen is, maybe you can see. Whoops, I wanted to go back. Maybe you could see him riding far there in the distance. This is another shot of, that's actually me in the yellow raincoat. But you get the sense of the distances we covered with the cows. Um, when I had seen and felt, experienced so many of these moments and decided I wanted to paint them, I had to think about what was it that I wanted to, what was it I wanted to show? What did I want to share? What was I trying to hold on to for myself? I thought it was maybe the physical experience of being there, the unity of the horse and rider, the vision of the intense colors, the rapid changes in the sky. But then I realized it was also the emotional experience, the awe. So this one is called Light Breaks Through. That's the picture I showed you before. This painting is from an early morning vision on Spring Mountain, was where the top of our ranch was, where we took the cattle. It gives me the feeling of being small in this vast space, of being inside something mysterious. Notice that in this morning scene, the sky, in fact, is the darkest thing in the painting. Oops. And I called it Clouds Like Smoke, which I think is about the duality that I keep finding in all of these paintings. Are those white and gray marks, which were so much fun to make, are they clouds or are they smoke? Are they the tender, soft clouds that sit low in the early morning so beautifully? Or are they something more dangerous, a sign of a fire, which we were always aware of? In fact, we once were in a fire and lost cattle in a fire. So there's that fear piece that comes in again, the fear within the beauty. Whoops. This next one I called Breaking Through Fog. It's another early morning image, another image again from a photo of mine. That morning, actually, we were going to go out to move cattle, and it was so foggy. The fog was so heavy that we almost didn't go. And then the guy said, it'll be fine. The fog will burn off. So we got up there, and there was absolutely no visibility. There were actually two riders ahead of me that day, and they kept disappearing in the fog and reappearing, especially when I would try to find my camera to try to capture the image. And then I would look up, and they'd be gone. But I can remember that feeling of wonder, of mystery, and certainly fear on that day when I would lose sight of them. I didn't quite know if I was going left or right. When I made this painting, I put only one rider ahead of me instead of two, and I struggled and kept changing my mind. Was the rider moving toward the viewer? So I would draw the rider where you could see the head and see the horse's head. Was the rider moving away from the viewer, which was mostly the rear of the horse? And so I repainted it many times with different colors and different positions. And I think ultimately that helped me to get that feeling of confusion or instability or loss or mystery. Is the rider someone you were trying to catch up with, or is it you reemerging from the fog? I keep finding these two opposite feelings at the same time, the paradoxes that scenes like this were both very calm and quiet and also confusing. They were ultimately beautiful, but also kind of dangerous. This next one is, most of the time, actually, when we were moving cattle, the weather was gorgeous and clear and the sky was blue. This again is a narrative. The story, whoops, how did I get to the next one? The storyline here is actually moving cattle along the fence line. The cows are spread out and the crew's job is to gather them together and put them through a gate in that fence. The paradoxes I see here are again that small and large. The rider is so tiny in the picture and the spaces are so big. The rider is a small human on top of a large animal. I feel it somehow that the textures of the paint and the foreground came out really velvety, which is such a contradiction because in fact it was, the ground was really hard and rocky and not easy to walk over. The sky has the beautiful soft clouds, but also the dark cloud hanging up on top. What was especially important for the painting, I think, was that brown, that reddish brown sliver of distant hill separating the land from the sky. I think that was important for giving depth and distance and contrast. This next one could probably be the next scene in the same story. This is called Cattle at the Green Gate. So imagine that if we're making this a story, that in fact we had successfully moved the cattle up to the gate, or the cattle had actually found their way to the gate. This is a pastel. I work in pastel a lot also. When I gave this the title At the Green Gate, it made me realize that it was the green of the gate that was what interested me most. And then when the green of the gate got next to the purples of the path leading up to it, which were then next to the oranges and yellows in the grass, then the painting began to come together to me. Can you guys see the pointer I'm using?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So see this middle section here with the bright green of the gate and the purple of the path and the yellows and oranges.
Yes.
I think that's my favorite part of it. Probably helped by that cow with his white face. You all know, I'm sure, about colors, about primary colors, that red and yellow and blue are the primary colors, which means that you can't make them from any other colors. When you combine red and yellow and blue, that you get the three secondary colors. So blue and yellow make green, blue and red make purple, yellow and red make orange. And I wound up with those three secondary colors together in that corner. And then the blue sky was important to me too. This is a picture of fall in the part of Wyoming where we were, which was always spectacular because of the intense yellows and oranges of the aspens. And I'm not quite sure I realized till I was putting these back to back that the same color combination was going on. Those oranges, so many different oranges and yellows in those trees, with their shadows being deep reds, deep red, purple. And I think I got lucky that the cabin there was green. So I had all my secondaries all together. But again, that's what I'm thinking about as I'm painting it. And then when I step back from it, I think I'm hitting the same notes of the viewer, of the person being so small in this huge space. These next three slides, well, this is a continuation of, I didn't realize quite what a narrative I was getting here. This is the same time of year with the aspens so powerfully yellow. But something was starting to change for me in my paintings. And I put these three together because they were kind of telling this, at least for me, telling the same story about my work. They're still about the riders, and they're still about being out with the cattle, but what gets more important is the large shapes and the altered colors, the triangles of the road. And in this one, for example, the rider, you see that it's about two riders moving away from you into the distance, but the feeling for me comes from all of those triangles that are leading back into deep space. The three triangles that make up the path, the yellow and the purple, all those green triangles that lead you back toward that same corner. I think, and I struggled with this painting, I remember, and I think it finally came together for me when the purples in the front got strong enough to balance the yellows up at the top. And then the same thing is happening in this one. There's lots of triangles going back in space. Probably there's real riders. You can see this rider pretty realistic right in the front. And then there's another one right here in the middle of this yellow. The colors are getting even more from my imagination, still rooted in reality. There are greens in those hills. There are yellows in those hills. The cattle are brown, but the colors are getting a little more separated from the real moment and more abstracted. The title of this is Riding Drag, and the story of it and the event is that those riders they're moving a herd of cattle, and the riders at the way back are tasked with keeping all the stragglers at the back together and keeping them up with the cows that are moving faster in the front. And you can see, if you look up at the top of the painting, these are the cows that have already moved their way all the way up to the front. And these guys' job is to keep them moving up. But the story to me is starting to separate from the pure narrative of the cattle moving into the colors and the shapes getting together. I like to think of those shapes locking together, that there are, well, let me go back to that one a minute, that there are all these triangles and shapes that fit together and hold each other in place, almost like a jigsaw puzzle. And I think that's really apparent in this one too, which is again a cattle drive. And you can see, whoops, gets away from me. You can see the one rider in the corner here. And there's actually, and I know that all of these little brown dots are actually cows moving into the distant future, into the distant, not future, into the distant hills. But there's a little more mystery about what's really happening, and it's more about the shapes and how they fit together and fly to the back. This painting has this great S-curve in it too. If you follow the brown line of the cattle from the lower left to the upper right and then back and forward again, S's are really great in paintings. They really help move things around and hold together. This painting started as a charcoal drawing, and I did this large charcoal and didn't really love it, and then went back over it figuring, well, I don't love it, I can't ruin it. And I just went back over it and painted with pastel. And then it started to work for me. There were layers of color. There were things happening underneath. The blue at the top got, I think, especially mysterious. I didn't know if that whole, if the whole painting was moving back toward mountains or toward sky. So I liked that mystery. If I want to keep evoking that awe word again, there's the mystery part, the spiritual part. This is a photograph of me painting on my porch in Wyoming. And it really is true. I really was painting that day. And there was somebody, I had my computer. I was working with somebody on the computer and she took that shot of me. So you can see that it wasn't posed. I was actually making a painting. But the truth is that I didn't make these paintings from my porch or plein air, that the light changed too fast. The cattle wouldn't stop and pose for me. the outdoor conditions were just too challenging, too windy, too far away. So in fact, things were painted from photographs and in my studio. So this is a picture of me in my studio. I thought of this like a studio visit for all of you. I have a great studio in Long Island City that I share with two other artists. And if you came for a studio visit, besides the paintings that were on easels in the other part of the room, what would you see? What's on the wall? So behind me are some works in progress, some notes to myself, everything from a shopping list for what paints I need to little studies. One of those little handwritten notes is a quote from a show I saw. I don't know if any of you saw the Jennifer Packer show at the Whitney last year, which was just great. and she wrote something like, "I don't believe in representation. I've never seen a painting that looked real, but I've seen ones that felt real." And that's I realized that's what I want to do. I want to do paintings that feel real. Then on the right side of this photograph are a bunch of small paintings that are transcriptions. When I was in art school, one of the things we did was copy from different artists. And I learned so much from each one. And so I was curious what was actually on my wall right now. So this is what was on my wall right now in that picture. The upper left-hand corner is a charcoal copy of an El Greco painting, which is the View of Toledo, which is actually in the Met. You can't really tell from this image, but it's got these great shapes that move all the way up the mountain to the whatever it is, the monastery or the city up at the top. Going clockwise, the one next to it is a Matisse I'm sure when he was in or near Nice in the south of France. And I can see the things I copied from Matisse, the parts of the trees are blue, not green. How there's a sliver of ocean in the rear. How there are rooftops that click together and just hold that whole center tight together. The one under that is a copy of a painting by Franz Marc, who I think, I'm not sure how many he's not as well known because he died very young in World War I. He died at the Battle of Verdun. But then he became famous to me because the Nazis labeled his art degenerate. And when it was on the walls in Germany. I did this a long time ago and never took it off the wall. And I think I understand it better now, that those wildly expressionist colors and distant shapes. It really is a landscape with the horse in the foreground and the distant ground. It means a lot to me. And the one at the bottom is Richard Diebenkorn. Diebenkorn is a California artist who 20th century. This is probably from the early 60s. He moved between figurative painting from perception, what he saw, and and pure abstraction. Whoops. And I think this was, this painting was kind of at that in-between place that I like to think I am, where it's a real landscape. You can see the sky in the background. You see the fields on the right. You see the roads and the buildings leading up to it. But what's important is those blocks of color and how they relate to each other. And then above that to the left is a detail of a painting by Graham Nixon, who was my brilliant teacher at the New York Studio School. This painting is at the National Gallery in Washington, if you ever want to go find it. And I love the way the hands make that triangle and go edge to edge and all those other triangles that are formed by it. There are so many different blues in this painting. The skin tones, which sort of look realistic to me when I'm looking on my computer, are actually all purples and oranges. So that's what I'm looking at. And so this is the last painting I'm going to show you of my Wyoming paintings that was in my show, in the Capturing Awe show. Again, that really dark sky behind the fluffy clouds. There are really just three simple shapes in this painting: the blue of the sky, the soft shapes of the clouds, the single shape of the mountain. When I look at the pieces of melted snow and see those browns and the way they move across the mountain, I think I probably was thinking El Greco at that time. I like the way they dance up the hill. Is it still pretty reality based? It's got trees up at the top of the mountain and clouds. The simplicity of the shapes is probably helped by the white of the snow. So there you go. That was the end of my time in Wyoming. And then a transition happened. We sold our property there, and I didn't have access to the horses and the cowboys and the light and the colors. So I'm starting to think, what do I want to paint next if it wasn't literally the clouds or the hills, but somehow the experience? So I went back to the studio and took that long slope painting and did a few different versions of it. Really abstracting the colors. I used to say in Wyoming when I made paintings that I couldn't make a mistake about the color, because every color that I could paint really had existed somewhere there in nature. I think maybe that would be true of the sky and the clouds here, but we did see a lot of yellows, but I don't think there was ever a real fully yellow hillside like this with turquoise depressions. And then this blue one where the sky got more turquoise and different blues and purples to give shape to the unity of the hill. And this one, I think that probably the sky and the clouds appeared that way in nature, but I don't think I ever saw all of those pinks and magentas and reds and purples on a silver hillside, on a single hillside. So I was trying to work from my experience of the beauty of it, but to use color to try to capture it in a different way. And then last winter, my husband and I took a trip to Utah and hiked in these spaces with these big skies and hard surfaces and huge rocky slopes and physical challenges. And one day we hiked in a series of slot canyons on the Navajo Reservation. twisty walks between canyon walls, looking up at shapes of blue sky. And I had that aha moment. This is me going through the canyons. And I think you can see those dualities again, those paradoxes, the hard rocks and the soft forms, the small person, small vulnerable person with the large threatening rocks, somehow moving into the unknown, but still feeling protected. I also love the physical challenge that made me feel both overwhelmed by the scale of it and self-confident with the conquest of it. So I started to paint the slot canyons. And this was my first one, which was a charcoal. It started as a charcoal with more line drawing than I usually do, because I think I was trying to figure out how do you paint rocks? How do you get the different facets and textures? And then I added the pastel again over it. Certainly that was necessary for the blue sky. But you can also see, I hope, patches of purples and reds and other grays. So I kept going with the rocks. This is a pastel. This is one of the first ones I did. I kept trying each time to get that shape of blue sky different. This had my favorite oranges and purples, but somehow the purples are now going into pinks and the oranges are getting some deep reds. This is an oil from that same setting. What was important to me here, the story to me here was this entrance from the lower left into that dark space, because that was where I was walking. That was the path that I was following through these rocks. And I find when I show these to people that they're responding not so much to the danger of my passage, but the human forms in the rocks. When this was described as sensual, I was really surprised because I thought I was painting rocks and hard things. In all of these, I can't help but see anthropomorphic features. And I won't even point them out to you, because I find once I see them, I can't unsee them. I can't see the whole anymore once I've seen the figures. This is another oil of those same canyons. Again, a different shape of the blue sky. This one was a challenge because of so many different textures of the rock. Those foreground rocks on the left and the right were really pebbly and rough and had lots of pinks and light colors. Where the light hits on the back, the surfaces seemed flat and attracted the light in a kind of an even way. And then the layers of reds. So the play of the light, the shapes, that's what I was going for. This is another pastel. Same story, different shape of the sky. Pinks, which even now I have to admit become human and sensual. This one I think was just pure joy of color. Those reds were so spectacular that the reds and oranges just overwhelmed me. This is the last one, and I'm not sure it's finished. I put it in anyway. I wanted those lighter forms in the middle to look really bulbous and round in contrast to the flat edges, the flat faces of the rocks on the left and the right, that big purple shape overhanging us on the right, the drop down in the front. And this is an oil version of what I showed you a minute ago as a pastel. And it's kind of interesting to me to look at them side by side. This one feels a little more rocky to me, a little harder. The pastels are always feel a little softer. But I really liked those big purple shapes holding on to the blue in the middle. So those are about, I mean, I think altogether, maybe I've done 10 of this series of the slot canyons. And I haven't had another Western experience to compare it to now. So then I ask myself, what am I going to do next? What is it about the feeling of awe in these outdoor spaces of shapes of sky and color and light and strong forms that hold them together, that I'm interested in, that has unity with what I've been doing? And I realized that it was here all along in New York City. So I've been looking at new canyons that I'm calling urban canyons. And this one I even labeled a work in progress because I'm not sure where else it has to go, but it's pretty close. And I realize it's got my same parts, those crazy clouds and deep blue shades of sky and strong, hard forms that hold it together. I love New York City. I'm a real New Yorker, and I think New York is full of wonder and beauty. Sometimes it's a little scary, and it's often beautiful. So if I can paint all those things in the New York canyons, I can still call it capturing awe. So that's my story. That's where I am now. This is my last slide, and I put my website and email on it. And that's where I'll leave you, back in Wyoming, back in a foggy morning, with my thanks for your interest. And thank you, Carol. And thank you, Ed.
That was wonderful. Really excellent in all regards. And a lot of fun for us to share.
Thank you.
So at this point, would people like to ask questions? And I'm sure that there are going to be a number of questions from the audience.
I can't see people because the slides are up, so I won't be able to see if anyone raises their hand, Carol.
Okay, so Susan, can you discontinue the share? Okay.
Right. But I hope, I would like to be able to show you slides again. So let's see, I'm gonna, okay. How can I do that?
I see when you had the slides up, Susan, I saw everybody in a, you know, just tiny, but I could see everybody.
Where is my stop share?
I just took the screen share down.
Oh, okay. So
we're all set now for the moment. If you want to reshare, you can just.
Great, I'll do share screen. Gotcha. Okay.
And if anyone has a question, you can unmute yourself as well.
Shall I start out with a question, Susan?
Sure.
From the standpoint of the capturing awe, mm-hmm. How do you in New York separate the strength of the canyon and the strength of the sky from all the people walking by?
That's an easy one. Look up. That's really what I've been doing, and I find that's what gives me that shape of sky that I want. It's being at a low angle. That's what gets giving me the angle of the buildings. I've been taking pictures of side streets where the buildings come together on a side street, and, you know, especially looking west at a sunset, and it is filled with people. But mostly it's the first answer, looking up.
Well, I just want to say, I don't have a question, but I enjoyed it so much. Your art is beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing it.
Thank you.
And I think Linda Brim has a question.
I'm going to ask it again, Susan, because I'm always fascinated. How do you know when a painting is finished?
Oh, God.
You know, you mentioned it a bit, but I'm always intrigued because.
Okay, I haven't quoted my teacher Graham enough. Graham's answer to that was, when if you change one thing, you've got to change everything else around it. Mm-hmm. So it's when all the parts are holding together and relating to each other. Mm-hmm. So for me, I think it's when I look at something and I say, that corner, just nothing's happening there. The rest of it has got a little song going on, but nothing's happening in that corner. Sometimes a good technique is turn a painting upside down, and some, it's easier to see upside down what's working and what's not working. Mm-hmm. Does that help?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was interesting for me around awe as well, because that's the emotional piece in it, you know, so kind of when you feel like it captures something that you experienced, is that part of it too?
Do you know, in truth, that only comes afterwards. I think I choose the image. I think I start with something that engages me, something I find beautiful. I don't want to use the word awesome, it's overused, but something I find exciting, different, out of balance, something that I want to paint. So that's probably the moment that I've got the awe. And then truly I forget about it until I figure out how to make the painting. Painting is hard. And until I figure out every shape and every color relationship, like I said, that one of the two riders riding away that I struggled with so much, it was just boring, boring, boring. And I put it away multiple times. And then finally, when I started making the colors of the road in the foreground wilder, then it began to work for me. But I really wasn't going for awe. I was going for, this painting is boring, and how do I make it? How do I give it energy?
Thanks. Thank you. Interesting. Yeah.
Oh, Judy?
Susan, I just saw the MoMA exhibit of Georgia O'Keeffe's drawings.
Yeah.
And I got that sensuous feeling from her drawings that you really gave to your drawings of the Slide Canyons. It's that same feeling of overwhelming awe at the immense beauty of our, you know, of all these natural formations and colors. It was beautiful to see there. And I love these new pictures of yours.
Yeah, thank you. Georgia O'Keeffe is obviously an influence here too. If I had had another photograph of the other wall in my studio, you would have seen a copy of a fairly large copy of Georgia O'Keeffe, which looks a lot like my canyons. And I saw that show last week also. And it said a lot to me. What I'm remembering now, thinking about it, is the simplicity. How, mm-hmm. do you remember that series of watercolors she did of the inside of the tent? The first that was, you know, and then it just became like two forms by the end. It was almost backwards, that it started a fairly simple watercolor. And by the time she got to her last version of it, it was just three or four marks, but simple and beautiful. So that's a message I took home.
Wendy.
You're muted, Wen. You're muted.
Got it, sorry. You know, I've seen most of the stuff, Suze, but I loved hearing you talk about it because I never, the technical part about those are the secondary colors. There's purple and orange. I thought, oh, there's purple and orange and green.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I like very much hearing the behind the scenes work.
Yeah, right. Yeah, how the sausage gets made.
Yeah,
it's hard. It's when I first put this together and I was working on my title, Capturing Awe, I was feeling a little too floaty, you know, a little too ungrounded. And when I started to point out things like, how do these lines move into the distance? Or how do these shapes lock together? How do these colors relate? I was learning from it, so seeing that my work together that way.
Any other questions? Jean.
Jean.
You're muted, Jean.
Good.
Shouldn't be. There we go.
There you go.
I just love the geometry, Susan, and I like how that's become more and more important to you.
Yeah.
Because that's a very solid thing in reality, geometry. And yet you have kept the awe in it by the use of color in your marks. So I think it's just going to be so exciting to see what happens next. I think you have to do a talk next year.
Yeah. Well, the geometry is a challenging thing in painting New York. I have really resisted painting New York City landscapes because I'm overwhelmed by the complexity of the buildings. I think that's why I picked the one image I did, because it was pretty simple low rise. When I look out my window and I see this buildings upon buildings, it kind of overwhelms me. But if I think of it in geometric terms, then what I've got to do is simplify and just find squares within squares. Okay, thank you.
And your mark is getting very beautiful. So, you know, that enlivens everything and puts awe in it.
Thank you.
So thank you for such a great talk.
Thank you.
I see Nancy and then Kathleen.
So I enjoyed every second, but I have to say, I was just in Sedona that has all these beautiful red rocks and beautiful views. And it was like, wow, you know, you've seen one red rock, you've seen it all. But I did think even then, but even more so now, if I could see these rocks through Susan's eyes, I would see something different. And, you know, so maybe someday I will. But I can't wait to see your New York landscapes because I think they're going to be really transformative for you and for us.
Well, we'll see. Thank you.
Kathy?
Yeah, I love your paintings. I was wondering, how do you decide what medium to use, whether watercolor, pastel? How do you decide that?
That's an interesting question. I don't do a lot of watercolor. I try to do watercolor when I travel because it's just so easy to, it's much easier to carry around. And most of my training was in oil. But when I discovered pastel, there was something so much quicker about it. the colors, you didn't mix colors. You picked a color from your table and put that color down. And often I wouldn't have the color I thought I needed, but I'd put down something close to it and it would expand what I thought I was doing. Pastels seem, oils are really hard. Oils are, the oils you can change over and over again, so you're almost never done with oils. Pastels, the paper only holds a certain amount of pastel, so you can only do so many passes at it and often have to be satisfied with what you've got. And I'm not sure if that's a very good answer. It's a hard question.
Thank you.
Michael.
Are you
muted?
Okay, no, I just, one comment. I'm not very well grounded in painting and the arts. I'm a rare museum goer. But the notion of capturing awe for me this evening is the awesomeness of a painter explaining. I think it would be nice to have you behind each of your paintings to explain the thought and the evolution and that goes with it. And the paintings in themselves are beautiful, but enlightened with your comments, your views, and the evolution that goes with it, that's awesome in itself. So thank you.
Thank you.
I don't see any other questions.
Well, that's good enough for me. I thank you. Thank you all for showing up. Thank my dear friends for tuning in and all your comments.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Susan.
Thank you. Thank you, Carol.